Greetings once again, brothers and sisters, in the name of Him who is our Redeemer, Liberator, Savior, and our Lord, whom I hope and God knows I pray that you are still serving and worshiping every day and not simply on Sunday, for this is the day that the Lord has made and we will and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Yes, you are still worshiping at the historic Lynch Street Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, 2175 John R. Lynch Street in the historic capital city of Jackson. Well, we are still, even though this is literally 1 year that we've been out of the building, today marks 1 year that we've been out of the building, but we're still making disciples one by one in the 21st century. We are still seeing Christ in everything we do, and everybody still is somebody. Thank you so very much for joining us today. We know, we have sense enough to know that you could have been anywhere you wanted to be. You could have been worshiping anywhere, but we just want to thank you week after week, month after month, that you've joined us at the historic Lynch Street. We don't take it for granted. We want to ta-ta you for listening in. So sit back and relax and enjoy this service today as we continue to celebrate between now as well as the end of this month, National Women's Month. Congratulations to all of the outstanding women in general and our African American queens in particular, born between the Euphrates and the Tigris River. God bless you and keep you is my prayer. Be blessed, be blessed, be blessed, and let's have a good service today.
Mercy endureth forever.
good. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his people. Pastor, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is, you are good. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. Amen. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. In whom do we believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints and the forgiveness of sins and the resurrection of the body, life everlasting, amen. At this particular time, we will now have prayer by one of our own, Reverend Barbara Martin. She's been a mainstay at this church for a long time. She will now lead us to the throne of grace.
Good morning. Glory, hallelujah. As we continue celebrating Women Month, join me in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our merciful Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name. We come before you this morning as humble as we know how. We come in confessing our sins, Lord God. Please hear our prayer and forgive us of our sins that we've committed through our thoughts, through our words, and through our deeds. Lord, we're not worthy of your love. We're not worthy of grace or your mercy. But you, Lord, have brought us to this day. And we just thank you and praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord God, for touching the hearts of many who provided water in our time of drought. Thank you for vaccine in the time of pandemic and allowing us to see a drop in the death count. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for the passing of the stimulus check in Washington, D.C. that will put food on the table and will pay some bills, Lord God, and bless some families. Bless and protect the President of the United States as he tried to serve his duty. Lord, we pray that everything will be done decently and in order, and one day maybe won't want to call it. But we just thank you, Lord. Father God, we enter this month of March in our nation's life. We enter it to reflect on the stories, on the heritage, and the struggles of women throughout the ages. We seek to learn from all those voices that have been left unheard. We call on Lord God to meet our needs and satisfy our desires, Lord. We desire to be women of prayer who cry to you without ceasing as our ancestors did. Lord, may this spiritual practice bring out the voices of all of those struggles and all of those that's left apart. Lord, today we begin celebrating the strength and the power and courage and faith of women across this world. Year after year, Lord, you were with those visionary women and met and marched and mobilized to prove what should have been self-evident, but Lord, you know they couldn't have done it without you, and we just thank you for it. We praise you, Lord God, for the virtuous women who persevered throughout yesterday's, Lord, and impact our today's and shaped our tomorrow's. God, we praise you for your love for every woman on this virtuous service. Lord, teach us to trust your design and seek the divine destiny that you have for every woman in every corner of your universe. Father God, we come now asking you to bless our pastor and bless the first lady. We're praying that you anoint the speaker as she delivers your word. And when this service and celebration is done, we will be careful to give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
At this time, my brothers and my sisters, we will now have our Old Testament scripture, which will be read by our own Sister Dorothy Longenow, and our New Testament scripture will be read this time by Songbird. And then afterwards, we will have a selection by Songbird.
Good morning. I will be reading out of the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verses 18 through 20. And it reads, "Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The beasts of the field will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, because I give waters in the wilderness and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, my chosen." I've read Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 through 20.
Would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? I will be reading Matthew 16, 13 through 18. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some say Elias, and others, Jeremias, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." May God add a blessing to the hearers, readers, and doers of his mighty word.
Amen. It's a lot of other things may lose its power. Salt will lose its power. Amen. It loses its strength. Oh, yeah, yes, it will. I remember I was doing something the other day. They were giving me some of those, that steak. Thinking about that big, thick ribeye steaks that Dorothy can cook over there at her place, Dorothy Long, you know, they have some big ribeye steaks, so don't kid you about that. But anyway, she has some good steak, ribeye steaks, and she know how to do those ribeye steaks. And so what happened, we had some A1 sauce on there. My wife loves to watch the expiration. What date is it? Then you bring that stuff all the way up from Carolinas? Yeah, I probably did. Well, what date is it? 15 or 16 or 7. I said, well, no, you ain't going to throw mine in the garbage. You don't put that on yours. I'm going to put the A1 sauce on mine because it still tastes good. It would still look like the old end garbage. It's good and good. But what happened was it wasn't have as much strength as the new ones would have because it lost its power. See it? But I know something that will never loses power, and that is the blood of Jesus. Isn't that some over 2,000 years? That blood is still strong over 2,000 years. Amen. It will never, never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley of the blood of Jesus will never, ever, ever, ever lose its power. I greet you once again, brothers and sisters, those of you around the world. Thank you so much for joining us each and every week. Wow, our YouTube is getting better and better and gooder, and people are following you all. I don't know how much they follow in the sermon, but I know how much they follow in the singing, you know. Well, but they're following all of us. Thank you so much for following us on YouTube all over the whole wide world. So we do greet you in this historic church. This will be the first Sunday. I did get it right, finally. This is the first Sunday that we were out of the church. What happened, John, if you remember, we all were there, if y'all remember, Brother Hubbard, the first Sunday in March, we were in service. We were there first Sunday in March. So this past first Sunday, as you already can see, you know, we were in church that last first Sunday. But the next Sunday, if y'all remember, we were not. Because you all were not playing that next Sunday because we were not in church and we were trying to regroup and see how we were going to work this thing out. So this is the first full year that we really have not seen all of these wonderful pews being filled with so many wonderful people here in this church. So again, I'm so grateful. But the Lord has brought us through. So many of you, I wanted to say, change up a little bit. Congratulations to most of you who've taken shot number one and certainly shot number two. Come on, let's give that a hand. Shot one and shot two. Have you gotten your first shot? Not yet, but you're going to get it. All right, what about you, brother? You all, you, John?
I'm good. First shot.
First shot.
First and second.
Huh?
Me.
You first and second. Well, I want to let you all know, after you take your second shot, according to the Center of Disease Control, there are 14 days following that, and then you'll be 100% in terms of vaccination. I just want you to know, it's 14 days after the second shot. I finished mine 2 days ago. My wife just finished her 14 days yesterday. So we're good to go now if we wanted to go on the plane or come into church or whatever. One thing about it, we are vaccinated from the coronavirus. That's what the Center of Disease Control said now. So let's try to get that. The quicker everybody is vaccinated, we can reach herd immunity. And as soon as we reach herd immunity, then we'll begin to start coming back and filling up these pews and coming back in church. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so very, very much for that. With that said, I want to share with you, brothers and sisters, that it's a new month, and during this month of March, it came in with a great bang, some time of a trying bang in terms of the water breakage. You all remember that it was something, wasn't it? And we were really affected here in the capital city of Jackson. I do want to say I'm so glad that the media is bringing attention to it all around the whole world, particularly the CNNs of the world, indicating that this is something that was ongoing way before the current mayor, This goes way, way back. This should have been fixed a long time ago. And we need money to make sure that this will never happen again. This was really bad when people have been out of water for almost a month. But I do want to thank the persons from around this country that are listening. Thank you, thank you, thank you for deciding to not only just zoom in to Jackson, Mississippi, but you all decided that you would want to bring your water to a Lynch Street CME church. We appreciate that. We appreciate that from our heart because we are a church of the community. So thank you so very much. We've had so much water. We had, what was that, Sister Chelsea? City Beverage. We had that, and they delivered about 300 and something cases not long ago. That was this past Monday, and also you all this past Saturday, two groups came down, one from Port of St. Paul. I'll get the other group first, coming from Humboldt, Tennessee. Kudos to you, Reverend Dr. Dal Coleman, and your wonderful church at Humboldt, Tennessee. Thought it not robbery to bring over 100 cases and some other things on yesterday to help the community. We appreciate you, Reverend Dr. Dal Coleman. And also, we want to thank you all for a number of people that decided together to pitch in and pay for it at Sam's in Montgomery, Alabama. And you had our church there at Port of St. Paul, CME Church in Northport, Alabama, 4 miles from Tuscaloosa. We appreciate you, along with some Christian bikers and some others that thought it not robbery to come down again this past Saturday, and they brought 16, all right now, I hope that that's that what was they saying? That was God. Oh Lord, have mercy. Love to have a little fun. But anyway, we want to thank you all as well for coming down. You brought 16 pallets of water. Three or four groups pitched in, and I saw, and some of you did too, because you saw it on your email that Pinky sent out. That was a big old long 18-wheeler with 16 pallets of water. So we want to thank you for sending it to us in the state of Mississippi in general and the city of Jackson and the Lynch Street CME Church in particular, that we might be the distributors as we are a church of the community. God bless you, and we appreciate it so very, very much. Ta-ta. Well, it is a new month, Brother John, and I think it's some birthday people here. I think it was Sister Chelsea first started out with her, and she had to celebrate her birthday. And she, it's your birthday, Chelsea, it's your birthday. It's your birthday, it's your birthday, it's your birthday. All right, so it's Sister Chelsea's birthday today, and she's celebrating with her and her girlfriends, and I understand that, you know. Yeah, I understand that they're gonna have a good time wherever they go tonight, wherever they did go. And we also had a shout out to Miss Bridget Houston. Mrs. Bridget Houston told me to tell the members of Lynch Street. She said, let me tell y'all something right now. She said, though I'm down at St. Petersburg, Florida, I want you to know that I'm an honorary member of Lynch Street CME Church, and starting this month, I want to be on the birthday list. And she told us that, what was it, March the 13th? Is that what that, whatever that, March the 11th is our birthday, and she wanted to make sure that she go on the list because she's an honorary member, because she starts seeing all of you all popping up at the end, and it just was too much for her, and she got a little jealous of it because she wanted to be part of it. So thank you so very much for what you do, Lynch Street Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. Let's say something about these birthdays. 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday, March! Come on, we can do better than that. Happy birthday, March! Well, someone in this spring decided to spring. Oh, we're supposed to spring forward today. I hope everybody sprung forward. We're supposed to spring forward on the 14th, which is today. You're supposed, so I hope that you all, if you're late, we already know what's going on. But we're supposed to spring forward on today. But there are some people that wanted to spring forward. What is it, daylight saving time? Is it daylight saving time now? All right, there are some folks that want to lose an hour of sleep. That's fine, that's what you really want to do. But you still wanted to get married during that time. So this is for you. It's your anniversary. All right now, anniversary. You know who you are. It's your anniversary. Amen. Thank you so very much. Please keep in prayer Sister Elizabeth Windham as the service for her son has been pending at this time. So it's pending right now. We don't know exactly when it will be, but please keep her and her family in prayer. She lost her son. And also keep also Brother Tart in prayer as we funeralized his brother this on yesterday. Thank you so very, very much. Please keep all of our sick and our shut-in in prayer. Galatians 6 and 2 said we are to bear each other's burdens. It's me this morning, but it's you this afternoon that's going through. So make sure that it behooves all of us to make sure that we have concern for each other. Do unto others as you would have them, not as they do, but as you would have them do unto you. God bless you and keep you is my prayer. Those are announcements for the day. We will now have a selection from our songbird. And then after the selection, just before the selection of our songbird, will be the introduction of our speaker by our distinguished president of the young adult, Sister Chelsea Glasney. And she will then introduce our special guest today. In every worship service, there should be an element of surprise. Let me parenthetically say, my brothers and sisters, for the next 3 weeks, we will be celebrating at this church National Women's Month. All over the United States, National Women's Month. And we will make sure that the women are involved in every facet of our church. Every facet of our services for the next 3 weeks, it would be basically all women. So this element of surprise, Sister Chelsea will introduce our guest preacher who will give the word for today.
Good morning. Our guest speaker today is Reverend Dr. Kathy C. Jones. Reverend Jones is the third of four children born to Mary Stonecross and the late Cecil Cross Sr. Born and educated in Chatham County, North Carolina, where she was in the first graduating class of Northwood High School in Pittsboro, North Carolina, she continued her education at Central Carolina Community College in Sanford, North Carolina, Wake Technical Community College in Riley, North Carolina, and the Bishop School of Ministry in Gastonia, North Carolina. She has also attended the Riley Institute of Biblical Studies in Riley, North Carolina. She obtained her associate's, bachelor's, and master's degrees from Justice Fellowship International Bible College in Riley, North Carolina. On May 21st, 2010, she was conferred her doctorate in biblical studies from Justice Fellowship Bible College in Jacksonville, North Carolina. She served as president of the Interdenominational Ministerial Allegiance for 3 years. Reverend Jones currently serves as the humble but proud pastor of Parkwood Institutional CME Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, where the Spirit of the Lord is transforming lives and illuminating hearts. In the Hidden Valley community where the church is located, they are investing time in activities that will draw the community to Jesus, our Savior. She continues to spread God's word by her preaching and teaching throughout North Carolina and other states. On December 1st, 2011, she offered the prayer for the opening session of the House of Representatives in Washington, D.C. She currently serves as the Dean of the Local Preachers for the Durham District of the Carolina Region of the CME Church under the leadership of Presiding Elder Clifton Harris, Jr., Chairperson of the Committee on the Ministerial Examination of the Carolina Region of the 7th Episcopal District of the CME Church under the leadership of Bishop James B. Walker, and was appointed by Bishop Walker as the 7th Episcopal District Representative of the Commission of the Concerns of Women's Ministry for the CME Connectional Church under the leadership of Senior Bishop L.L. Reddick III. She has been married to Mr. Theodore Jones for 36 years, and this union has been blessed with 7 children, 1 son-in-law, 5 daughter-in-laws, 19 grandchildren, and 11 great-grandchildren. She is a firm believer that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord, to those who are called according to his purpose. After the next selection, the next voice you will hear will be Reverend Kathy C. Johns.
Who can stand against the Lord? No one can. No one will. Who will stand against the King?
Come on now.
No one can.
Beautiful.
No one will. Oh,
yeah.
Oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. The against the Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord.
No one can.
Hallelujah.
No one will. Who can stand against the King? No one can. No one will.
Greetings, my brothers and sisters. I come to you today in the name of Jesus. I bring you greetings from Parkwood Institutional Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, 802 Tom Hunter Road in the Queen City of Charlotte, North Carolina. I come with a word this morning to lift your spirits, to lift your hearts, as the Lord declares that we be lifted. Bow your heads with me if you will. Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know, if thou withdraw thyself from me, Lord, whither shall I go? Use us today, dear God, for your glory. Father, let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray. Amen. Join us this morning, if you will, in our worship service. Join me as I go to the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verses 18 and 19. The word of the Lord declares, "Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." God bless you, my brothers and my sisters. Just for a few minutes, I want to talk from the subject, God is doing a new thing. God is doing a new thing. I believe, my brothers and sisters, that all of us need to know our roots. All of us need to know our founding principles. When we make statements that bring up what we need to do today, like what was done in the past, it implies that something is wrong with what we're doing today. Some people even say that something is wrong with our relationship with God because we make statements like we need to go back to the old time way. I believe that sometimes people feel like Paul did when he spoke to the church at Ephesus, when he was telling them that something had gone wrong. They had lost something. They had turned away from their first love. I do believe, my brothers and sisters, today in this time that we live in, I have no question in my mind that there is a difference or a lack of commitment prevailing in many churches. And I am certain that many churches have been have had some unpleasant circumstances and situations to face them in the past few years. But I'm convinced today that turning back the clock does not remedy those dilemmas. Some people honestly believe if preachers would preach the old-fashioned way, and if churches would hum those old tunes, those ancient songs, and if Christians conducted church like they did in days gone by, revival would take off uncontrollably with a high blaze. But it might surprise us that the Bible does not propose such a solution. I'm convinced that the cure for spiritual difference is not a throwback to the good old days. No, the Bible says the solution for spiritual renewal arises from the present. Listen to what God told Isaiah to write. He said, "See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland." You see, the reign of the Holy Spirit and the times of the refreshing of the Spirit come through a new experience with God Almighty. And Isaiah wasn't the only one understanding this. For it's recorded in the scripture, God had it expressed over and over and over again, the desire to do a new thing. He even started with the psalmist in Psalm 33:3. He says, "Sing to him a new song, play skillfully and shout for joy." He had Jeremiah to write in that 31st chapter in the 31st verse, "The time is coming, the Lord declares, that when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." He had Ezekiel to write in the 11th chapter in the 19th verse, "I will give them an undivided heart and put a new spirit in them." You see, when we consider the ministry of Jesus Christ and look at Mark chapter 1 and 27, it says, "The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, 'What is this? A new teaching with new authority?'" Paul said in his second letter to the church at Corinth, chapter 5, verse 17, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, all things have become brand new." Peter said in 2 Peter 3 and 13, "We're looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, and the home of the righteous." John picked up his pen and wrote down in Revelation chapter 21 and 5, he said, "He who is seated on the throne says, 'I'm making all things brand new.'" Yeah, the Bible has this issue firmly settled. God wants to do a new thing. And when we think about it, this is what we really need. We need a new thing. You know, right here in this day and time, we need a new thing. If you don't believe me, let me ask you, how would you rather God restore your 10-year-old automobile, or would you just let him, would you prefer him to just give you a brand new one? Or would you have God to restore your 5-year-old computer or your device? Or would you just rather him supply you with a new one? Y'all see what I'm talking about. You see, God's thoughts toward us today are the same. He wants to give us a new heart. He wants to supply us with new vision. He wants to reign afresh on our parched land and give us a new harvest. But how do we allow God to do a new thing in our lives? I believe Paul turned the key and unlocked the door and seized the moment when he said, we got in Philippians, "We've got this one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind me. Yeah, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus." That's what Isaiah meant when he said, "Forget the former things and do not dwell on the past." You see, some of us dwell so much on what happened yesterday until we can't let yesterday go and come in to today. We have to understand that movements and waves of the Spirit constantly shift. And when God consummates a particular mode of operation in his kingdom, or even in our life, we should be willing to thank him for it, release it, and let him birth this new thing in us. What God did 10 or 20 years ago is a wonderful thing. Don't get me wrong. But it was a new thing back then. Anybody gonna pray with me? Now God requires us to seize the moment by accepting something new. That's why we need to pray for God to give our souls a new and flexible wine skin. Yeah, because you know, like I know, that you can't put old wine in brand new wine skin. Somebody ought to pray with me. Yeah, when I thought about this new thing and how we can allow this to happen, you see, a new thing requires living by faith, not living in fear, but living by faith. There's a reason that God asks us to accept new things. It's because the issue of faith is at stake. Faith isn't activated, my brothers and sisters, by looking back. It's released by participating in God's current activity. When we exhibit excessive affection to a past movement of God, when we cuddle it, when we venerate it, and when we talk about it like there will never ever be anything better, it means that doubt and fear has crept in, and we assume that God can't improve on what he did years ago. Somebody ought to hear me. But I'm thankful for the spiritual movement. Don't get me wrong. I'm glad about the spiritual movements. I'm thankful for what happened years ago. But it takes no faith to live in the past. It takes no faith to talk about the good old days. It may create goosebumps and you may have warm and fuzzy feelings. But clinging to the past won't move us forward. Staying back there won't help us to take a step forward. When we read the Bible, we'll see that God used people to do a new thing that was untested and unconventional. Yeah, you see, God commanding Noah to construct an ark. Yeah, build it of gopher wood, build it several feet high, several feet wide, build it so it'll be large enough to take two of every living creature on to that boat. Build it like I told you to build it, and then let it sit out there in the water. That was a new thing. When Moses installed Joshua as Israel's new leader, Joshua's first command to Israel was to march around the walls of Jericho. That was completely untested and unconventional. He used some military strategy. Yeah, it was a new thing when Elijah commanded the Assyrian general by the name of Naaman to dip 7 times in the Jordan River to remove the leprosy from his body. It was new and it was different. Yeah, Jesus walking on water and pasting blood on the eyes of a blind man and dividing a lunch basket to feed over 5,000 people. That was a new thing. Somebody ought to pray with me. The Holy Spirit sweeping over 120 believers with wind, fire, and tongues was a new thing. You see, Peter's shadow passing over the sick, and Paul's swatches of sweaty clothes being carried to the infirm had never been practiced by Jesus or any of the Old Testament prophets. But you know, like I know, that miracles follow. Yeah, when we allow God to move in our lives in a way that is new, something happens. If you don't believe me, let me call somebody from the Old Testament. Come here, Moses. Moses, shortly after he delivered the Israelites from Egypt, they approached Canaan. The plagues had shaken Egypt, and the Red Sea had opened for Israel's passage into freedom. You remember all those signs and all those wonders God used to deliver Israel. They were great. They were spectacular. And I'm sure the Israelites assumed they would quickly overtake Canaan. But God had a different plan. Somebody know what I'm talking about. God had a different plan. Instead of leading the Israelites on a short, straight route into Canaan, God led Israel on the longer scenic route. And while God had a predesigned purpose for all of that, Israel didn't understand it. But true to Israel's reputation, instead of willingly submitting, they did what they did best. Yeah, they grumble, they mumble, and they complain. For in the book of Numbers, chapter 21, verse 5, Moses became impatient. Israel became impatient and grumbled against God, against Moses. And they grumbled about the food that they ate. But God had a cure for their mumbling. He sent some venomous snakes into their camp. And we need to understand that it doesn't take long to start repenting when you got vipers coiled up around your tent poles. But do you remember how God answered their repentant prayers and brought healing for the snake bites? God had Moses to shape and raise a brass serpent in the midst of the camp. Moses told the people if they wanted to be healed, all they needed to do was just look at the serpent. Sounds like something new to me. Just look at a serpent. My brothers and my sisters, that was a new thing. When people are healed by looking at a serpent on a pole, that's different. Moses could have questioned God. Moses could have said, Lord, what in the world are you doing? Lord, this sounds like something really ridiculous to me. A solution for these snake bites, a serpent on a pole. There must be a better way to deal with this. But Moses didn't question God. He obeyed, and y'all know what happened. God began to work miracles. I'm trying to tell you, when we allow God to do some new things in our lives, he'll work it out better than we ever thought it could be worked out. When I thought about what Moses did, I realized with 2 or 3 million Israelites traveling through the wilderness, most people couldn't see the serpent just by looking out of their tent doors. The distance was too great, and there were too many visual obstructions that would prevent a clear view of the bronze serpent. The thousands of tents that were cast out there would prevent the folk from looking at the serpent. But when I consider, here's what I believe, here's what I realize. While God had a remedy for this situation, and even sent it right into their midst, the people had to do something. God sent the solution, but Israel had to position themselves so that they could see God offering the healing. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Israel had to get into a perceiving situation. My brothers and my sisters, as I get ready to close now, there may be 1 million steps that separate us from God. And God will take 999,999 steps to get to where we are. but he's gonna leave just one step for us to take, and it's called a step of faith. That's why I believe the old folk used to say, if you make one step, he'll make two. I believe that God will. When we make that step, it'll acknowledge that we have faith in him. It'll acknowledge that we trust him. It'll acknowledge that if he holds out his hand, we'll want to reach out and take it. I'm so glad today, if we believe that God is real, we'll be ready to make a step toward the Lord. If we don't believe that we're going through some things, and God is able to do a new thing, we need to take a look around at what's gone on since March of this year up until this present time. My brothers and my sisters, if we can't see that we need something new, something is terribly wrong with all of us. God has brought us to a place where we can no longer do business as usual. We gotta learn to step out on faith. We gotta learn to practice what we preach. We gotta learn to put our money where our mouth is. We gotta learn to trust in the Lord with all our hearts. Lean not to our own understanding, but in all our ways, acknowledge him. And somebody know that he will direct our paths. And when God directs our paths, he'll allow some new things to happen in our lives. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. God, we magnify your name for doing a new thing in our lives. Give us the courage to accept your will and your way as it is being done. Forgive us for mumbling, grumbling, and complaining. Forgive us for not heeding to your word. Forgive us for getting out of order. Forgive us for not loving like you tell us to love. Have mercy upon us, O God. Use us for your glory and show us, oh God, continue to show us that we're in your hands and you're in control of our lives. We'll forever bless your name and give you praise. For it's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. God, if there's one today that desires a new thing in their life, touch their hearts, touch their minds right now. And lead them in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. We'll forever bless your name and give you praise. And all of us together said amen.
At this time, the door to church is open. If you've never experienced any victory in your life, there is one whom paid the ultimate price on the cross. He died for us all. We're all sinners, saved by grace. If you're looking for a church home, if you're needing prayer, needing someone to talk to,
come on now.
There are numbers that are on the screen. Somebody will answer. Someone is available for you. You are not in this by yourself.
All right now.
We have all been
there. Hallelujah.
We have all been through. We've all needed that special touch that only he provides. He's been our way maker. He's been our wheel in the middle of a wheel. Psalms 23, three important words: the Lord is. Now the Lord is anything that you need him to be. He can be your mother. He can be your father. He can be your sister. He can be your brother. But most importantly, he's that ultimate friend. That friend when nobody answers on the other end of that phone line, he's there to talk to. But as I've stated before, look at those numbers that are on your screen and call. At this time, the door of the church is open.
Sisters,
moving
Thank you so very much, the Reverend Dr. Kathy C. Jones, the distinguished pastor of the Parkwood, Historical Parkwood Institutional Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, located in that wonderful Queen City of Charlotte, North Carolina. Thank you so very much. What a word today. As we continue to play the music and we continue Songbird, I'll come right back up after I give the benediction. Thank you again for worshiping at Lynch Street. It's an honor, first of all, to be your pastor. It's an honor for you all to join us. We don't take it for granted. Thank you so very much for worshiping at Lynch Street. With that understanding, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon each of you and give you peace, 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 and give you peace. Not only now, but forevermore. May God bless you and keep you. And we will close out today with Songbird coming up one more time with that chord. So let's go again. Here we go. Bring it up. Oh.
I worship you.